Most talk shows, columns, and TV shows focus on the medical expertise of people they invite, medical experts, doctors. But today, with Room for Discussion, we want to focus on the ethical sides of the whole COVID pandemic, on vaccinations, but also, for example, on the vaccination passport and the distribution of vaccines. As a member of the Dutch Health Council, especially sitting in the commission for the vaccination, Roland Pierik will be sure to tell us everything and perhaps provide us a new insights into this pandemic. Dear Professor Pierik, thank you for being here.
Thank you for inviting me.
So I've never heard or read so much about vaccinations as I have done this year. Like, yes. It's everywhere. People are excited. People are skeptic.
Yes.
What changed your life? Did your life change anyway this year?
Well, it's funny. I started discussing vaccination or researching vaccination as a case study in my research on conflicting human rights. So one example is the right of parents to raise their children in the way that they see fit, and the rights of children to be protected against diseases, maybe the right of society to be protected against outbreaks of these diseases. And that was a very interesting case study for these, for the question of conflicting fundamental rights. But then it turned out that through all kinds of reasons, especially vaccine skepticism, the vaccination rate went down and new outbreaks could emerge, have emerged in Europe and could also emerge in the Netherlands. So then the question came not only to my academic interest, but also to the political interest: should more mandatory policies be introduced? And I was one of, I published on this field, so and then you're the first in line, and that implies that you were invited to every talk show, every anything. So you remain on top of it because all the new questions come to you. And it changed my life quite dramatically, well, not dramatically, it made my life more fun. Because what I studied from an intellectual point of view really became a legal and political dispute. And I could really use my ethical background to, for example, in the Health Council to advise about these conflicting rights. Because on the one hand, indeed, as you say, this is very much a question of medical expertise, but also a question on rights and duties. Under which circumstances can parents be mandated to vaccinate their kids, for example? Well, then you need ethical and philosophical background. And well, I was lucky that I was in the right place at the right time. And so I've been doing this for, well, years now.
Yeah. And do you think you have an actual impact on policy change or policy making?
Yes. We. So there was a proposal in the Tweede Kamer in government for legislation on vaccination by D66, Rens Rijmakers. And I thought it wasn't a good idea. At first I just sent an email to Rijmakers himself and I said, I don't think it's a good idea, but he said, well, I'm going to pursue. Then I wrote some articles for a Nederlands Juristenblad, which is kind of the academic paper for legal scholars in the Netherlands that is read by almost all legal scholars and by people in parliament. And I read some articles criticizing that proposal. And I also supported some two other parliamentarians who wanted to come up with another proposal. And I'm more or less the ghostwriter of that alternative proposal. And that proposal is more or less in line with what Marcel Verwij, I work with Marcel Verwij, what we have presented in our academic work. So yes, I'm sure we have some impact there, yeah.
So in your commission on vaccinations, yes. Are you the only legal expert, or is the rest medical, or is it also economists that are in there, anthropologists, psychologists?
No, it is people, medics, but also people who study outbreaks of diseases. And the funny thing is that the medics, they always want every vaccination to be introduced because they see the children falling ill, and they want these children to be protected against these diseases. Those who study these outbreaks of these diseases say, well, some diseases are so small, they don't justify the introduction of a general vaccination policy. And so they come from very different standpoints, and then I'm somewhere in between and try to mitigate between the two and say, well, which rights and which duties are at stake? And sometimes the rights of the children win, and sometimes the rights of the parents win.
But don't you think that it perhaps should be a bit more interdisciplinary? Because, for example, if you look at economy right now, there's a lot of critique that everything is ruled by medical experts, and indeed that they push for curfews and for restrictions.
Yes.
Do you feel like this team should be more interdisciplinary?
No, because on the one hand, it's already the committee is already big enough, and the committee should not be. It should fit around the round table. Otherwise, it won't work. The economics is introduced because we use the QALY assessment. So a vaccination can only be introduced if it improves the quality of life, and that's measured in years. So that's already in. And in specific cases, we can invite temporary experts. So if we have a new, for example, we had some vaccination that didn't involve children, but elderly people, then we didn't have enough people covering that field. And then we invite for a few meetings someone who's expert in that field. And I think, as it is, the committee is already quite interdisciplinary. But in the end, these are quite medical choices in the end, and epidemical choices. So I think we are quite well covered.
Yeah, because you just started a bit about vaccine skepticism.
Yes.
It's quite big. We now have around 2 in 10 people in the Netherlands who do not want a vaccine. And even in other countries, in Russia, there's sometimes some people measure 50% of the population that doesn't want a vaccination.
Yes.
There are, of course, people who think it's part of some conspiracy plot.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
But there are also people that just feel like it is made in within a year.
Yes.
It's made very quick.
Yes.
People relate to the 60s where things went wrong with the vaccine.
Yes. Yes.
Is their skepticism justifiable?
It's understandable. I can understand that people are skeptics, but I don't think it's justifiable because many things can be explained very well if people take the time to if people are allow themselves to be convinced by arguments. So the Russian case I can understand, because in Russia the vaccination was already introduced for the general public before the testing was finished. You shouldn't do that. It always backfires. And we see in Russia now, it backfires because people say, well, we have vaccinations that haven't been tested and that are already generally used. For the Netherlands, so the argument, normally it takes such a long time, now it only took 1 year, so it can't be good. You can make a comparison with if you have to go to the hospital for an operation. Usually it takes a few months or a few weeks before you can enter the operation table because there are waiting lines. But if you have a heart attack or if you have your leg broken, these things can go very fast. You could be there next day. And it's not that operation is less careful. It's just you work a different way. So, for example, for us in the health council, when we get an invitation to evaluate a vaccination, a new vaccine, usually it's on the pile. And we finish all the other work. And then we take our time and we have meetings every 2 or 3 weeks. So it takes a while before we come with that conclusion. Now, in the COVID situation, we know we can't use that procedure. So there is a special committee set up in November that focuses only on this COVID vaccination. And these people were required, so you can join. We want you to join us. You're an expert, so we want you to join us. But beware, during the Christmas break, we will have quite some meetings because we have to work fast. So I was in that committee. And then normally you get an invitation long before. You get the reports a week before to read, and then we discuss it. Now, these meetings sometimes are planned a few days before the meeting is there. We get the stuff 1 day before the meeting, and we discuss it right away. It doesn't mean that if we do it so fast that the decision is made less carefully. It's just that usually they have to wait for us. And now we know these things must be fast. So we organize our life or meetings around these new vaccines that come in.
But how do we convince people that the vaccine is safe? Because the things you mentioned have been said already,
yes,
and the news says it, but there's still 20% that,
yes,
doesn't get vaccinated, and herd immunity,
yes,
it probably won't be enough, the 80%.
Yes. Well, it might be enough, 80%. So at a certain moment, you come to a situation that was also with the childhood vaccination, that you can't convince persons with arguments anymore, because they are so in their own position that they're not open for arguments anymore. And I'm not sure what to do there. I think we should wait. There's not enough vaccines to vaccinate all of us. Except for the AstraZeneca, all vaccines seem to be very safe, very, very well working. It could very well be that the scarcity now could make the vaccine more attractive to anyone, because it's so scarce, apparently it's good. And I think around the time that people, the average person, say below 40 years old with normal health conditions, around the time that they are invited for the vaccination, the vaccines have been around for a while. They show to be very effective, very safe. And they also show that if we take the vaccine, then we can go back more or less to normal life again. So I think, of course, we should investigate now to what extent people want to take the vaccine, but we can only know at the moment when the vaccines are there. And I'm always, also in the childhood vaccination discussion, the moment when push comes to shove and it's really important, most people will take the vaccine.
Yeah, but I have a problem with waiting, because we see that these people who are anti-vaccination are trying to convince other people,
yes, yes,
enormously. We see it on Twitter, every Sunday we see play, there are multiple,
yes,
people,
yeah,
together.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We saw a website giving out free blenders,
yes,
to parents who
vaccinated
their children.
Yes.
So shouldn't the government actively prohibit this spreading of fake news? Or do you think the freedom of speech is more important here?
Yeah, this is another instance of conflicting fundamental rights. I think the freedom of speech is very important. But there's also another thing. Yes, there are always 500, 200 or maybe 500 people on the Museumplein every Sunday. That's 500 persons. There are 70 million people in the Netherlands. It's always the case that people who are quite fundamentalist against such a thing are quite vocal on the social media in these demonstrations. But it's very loud, but it's a very tiny minority of the people. I was more scared about the fact that Thierry Baudet got 8 votes, and I think
eight seats.
I know,
eight
seats.
A bit more than
and that's part not because of Baudet himself, but the other person, Haga, who is really a straightforward anti-vaxxer, and Baudet realized, oh, here's something to gain here, so he also started doing that. I'm scared about that, these people arriving in parliament. But I do think that the moment the vaccines, I'm hopeful that the moment the vaccines are there, we will arrive at the 80%, or maybe we only need 70% of vaccination. And then, I mean, if we can reach the 80%, we have herd immunity, then we can just let these other people be very happy with their ideas. But if herd immunity or group protection is achieved in society,
it doesn't matter.
I mean, it does matter.
Okay.
We should try to find ways to convince them. But sometimes it's very hard to convince people if you can't do it by arguments.
So at least not limit their free speech, because
that's just too fundamental.
Okay.
No, no.
Okay. Because you've written articles about mandatory vaccination for children.
Yes.
We've seen that Belgium has a mandatory polio vaccine.
Yes.
What is your opinion about the mandatory vaccination on COVID in the Netherlands?
In the Netherlands. So we should start by making very clear that there's a difference between mandatory vaccination for children and for COVID, because for COVID it's basically for adults who can make their own choices. Whereas childhood vaccination is for children who can't make the choice themselves, and the parents have to make the choice for their children. So in the case of COVID vaccination, these are adults. They make their own choices. Some people make very stupid choices. Some people smoke. Some people drink way too much. Some people don't go to the dentist. They make very bad choices. But here you should be, here's the idea of toleration. You should provide the vaccine, you should provide the dentist, you should make sure that they have access to these things if they want to, but you can't force them.
Well, because that's where a problem lies for me, because when you don't force them, you basically put others at risk.
Yes.
Especially if herd immunity isn't reached.
Yes, yes.
And we see more of dangerous COVID strains coming up.
Yes.
For example, we have the P1 strain now.
Yes.
That is three times as more deadly for teenagers than the vaccine we see now. So don't you harm the whole country with not mandatorily vaccinating these people?
Well, two arguments here. One argument is that I think these new strains don't develop in the Western world, but they develop in that part of the world where there are no vaccines at all. So if we are really committed to this idea, to protecting society, the Dutch society, we can only be protected if all are protected. So if you want to use that argument, fighting these strains, and I think it's important to do that, we should have much more focus on trying to bring as many vaccines as possible to the developing world who's unable to pay for themselves.
Yes.
So it doesn't really matter whether so from 60 to 70% in the Netherlands, it's much more important to go from 0 to 40% in countries where there's no vaccination.
Yeah, we'll talk about the vaccine distribution later.
Yeah.
But for now, I still want to focus because there are people who, for medical reasons, cannot be vaccinated.
Yes.
People that can take a vaccine but don't because of other reasons, put these people at great risk, especially because they have medical conditions, often they are vulnerable.
Yes.
Is the argument now really that it's allowed to put these people at risk just because you don't want a vaccination?
No, I think first we have to wait whether the voluntary vaccination does the trick.
Okay, but
it could
after that.
And if it doesn't do, then we should go a different route. And one way of doing that could be these vaccine passports. So if you don't vaccinate, there are some places you can't go anymore. And that is, you're not forced to be vaccinated, but if you don't vaccinate, specific, very pleasant things are not available to you. And that could be another way of kind of indirectly forcing these persons to take vaccination. So we had the same discussion on the childhood vaccination when the measles vaccination rate went down. So the proposal we discussed earlier was to propose that if the vaccination rate is too low and herd immunity is undermined, then parents can only bring their child to a daycare center if the child is vaccinated or if the child is in the program. So what you do then is, there are some parents who are really, really against vaccination, and they take the choice to take the kid from daycare centers. But there are so many parents who didn't really think about it, but just forgot to vaccinate or said, well, I don't know, let's just postpone and then have to do it. These parents, if you say, well, your kid can't go to daycare center anymore, then they really think, then it would really have a consequence. And these, we call the low-hanging fruit, these parents who are on the fence but not really, they will take the vaccination. And this is a way, you don't force vaccination, but you say, well, if you don't vaccinate, some things are not available to you, and that might do the trick to get back to the 80%. And you could do the same here in the COVID vaccination. If you don't vaccinate, you can't go to a restaurant. You can't fly with KLM. You can't go to a bar. You can't go to a concert. I think that many persons who are kind of reluctant but not really will take the vaccination because they want to go back to a normal life. And then you arrive at the number you need for herd immunity without forcing those who are really against vaccination. But that's really tough to vaccinate someone who's really against vaccination.
I don't agree on this topic because this vaccination passport basically restricts your civil liberty.
Yes.
And I feel like a lot of people would argue they would rather pay a 500 euro fine.
Yes.
As a punishment, so yes. that with a yes. mandatory vaccination, then be limited to go to festivals or sports clubs or cinemas. But isn't it a vaccination passport basically a mandatory vaccination?
No. What is mandatory is our new situation in COVID where you have a duty to make sure you don't infect other persons. That's mandatory. That's your duty. That's the duty we have now. And you can take the duty in one of two ways. Either you stay at home, as we have to do now. That's one way of making sure you cannot infect other persons. Or if you want to go out, then you take the vaccination. But if you don't want to do that, we go back to square one and you go back to stay at home again. So I do think that it's your choice whether you want to protect others through staying at home or whether you want to do it through vaccination.
But isn't that the same as with mandatory vaccination? Because it's your choice to either pay the fine,
yes.
fine and don't take a vaccination, and go outside and take a vaccine and don't pay the fine.
So two arguments there. One is, if some people will pay the fine, but if enough persons will take the vaccination, we should have a gritted teeth toleration towards those who don't want to do it. We say, yeah, I don't like what they're doing, but I can't force them. But I can also reply the question to you. What kind of mandatory vaccination would you prefer here? Would you really want to have to please go out in the street and grab people and vaccinate persons? Or would you give that a fine? Because if you say, if you don't vaccinate, you will be fined 1,000 euros. There also will be people who want to pay that. So. You want to have the least restrictive measures that does the trick of generating herd immunity. And you have to accept in a liberal democracy that some people make very stupid choices that also affect other persons. As long as herd immunity is protected, and I agree with you that if voluntary COVID vaccination in the end doesn't end up in herd immunity, then government should do more. Because government, in the end of the day, we need herd immunity against COVID. I do think, again, voluntary vaccination will do the trick. If that's not the case, then I think that these vaccine passports are the least restrictive means to achieve the goal. Because really making vaccination really mandatory and putting people in jail if you don't vaccinate, that is quite a harsh measure in a liberal democracy.
That goes too far for liberal democracy.
Yes.
Well, luckily there are a lot of people that do want to vaccinate.
Yes.
But do want to be vaccinated.
Yes.
Not everyone can get it in one day. There's now in the Netherlands, what we do is all the people go first and people who are medical experts or at least are at risk.
Yes.
But if we look at, there are quite some other scenarios thinkable. Teenagers that are the main spreaders, students.
Yes.
If you vaccinate all of them, perhaps we slow the spread of COVID. Or people who are filling the intensive care the most.
Yes.
There is an article published where people 50 years and older who are overweight, they all fill the intensive care.
Yes.
Shouldn't they get all vaccinated first? What is your opinion on who is first?
Well, my opinion is in line with the opinion of the Health Council because I was involved with this decision. Our argument was, so we said you can follow different paths, and these are the paths that you already mentioned. So one is protecting the most vulnerable. One is to make sure that the spreading is to stop spreading by vaccinating the spreaders, or and another is to protect those who work in the hospital and are in contact with COVID patients all day.
To limit the spots in intensive care.
Sorry?
Want to limit the spots in
intensive care. That's the fourth part.
That's the fourth one.
The decision of the Health Council, and I agree with that, is that it is the older you get, the more risky COVID is for you. And even if you don't arrive, come at IC because you are 80 or older, still you are a person and you are very vulnerable to the disease. So we say, let's vaccinate them first, because they don't even go to the IC because they will die before that. If you go to the IC, there's still a chance for you to survive. Yes, yeah. All the people can't survive. They even don't even go to the IC anymore. And we said, since the risk is quite exponential, if you have age and you get older, it really explodes. So we said we should focus the persons who are most vulnerable first. But some people say, well, you should vaccinate the overweight men of my age. Well, that could be another strategy, but you could also say, well, then you kind of stimulate people getting overweight, because then they get their COVID vaccination first. Do we want that? I'm not sure. So the argument on the students who spread the disease, that could also be a path to go, because if you do that, then you indirectly also protect the older persons, because if the disease can't spread anymore, then the older persons are also protected. But we are not sure yet whether being vaccinated also stops the spreading. It could very well be, and we are, well, not we, because the medical experts in the field. So, one step back. In the case of measles, if you are vaccinated, you can't spread it anymore.
Yes.
In this disease, it could be that you don't feel ill anymore, nothing happens to you, but you could still spread. And we know now that the first few months after vaccination, you won't spread, but we also know that will return. So it might give some false security, because you are young, you're vaccinated, you know, I can, and you think I can do anything because I can't spread anymore. If it turns out that in the summer you spread again, you are the happy person going to all the festivals, spreading the disease. So if that's the case, then the path of protecting spreading through vaccinating the young person doesn't work. And we don't know yet to what extent the vaccination stops spreading. We do know that it protects the older person against falling ill, and it works very well.
But according to what you just said, then it doesn't make sense at all to vaccinate doctors, because we vaccinate doctors and medical experts now because to stop the spreading within hospitals. But you just mentioned that if it's not about the spreading, then why vaccinate these medical experts?
I'm not sure whether we vaccinate them to stop the spreading. It helps stopping the spreading, but it also, we need these persons not to be ill in the next peak. So that was another path that we could choose as health council, saying we have to vaccinate those who work in the critical places, for example, the ICs or what have you. So at least they will stay standing in the next outbreak, because if these people fall ill, then it all collapses. But here the health council said it turns out that these people are so well protected with their... They hate that stuff.
Yeah.
They hate it. But these masks protect very well. So that was one reason why we as health council said, well, they are protected in this way, and we should really put all the balls on all the persons, because they die.
So you basically disagree with now the government regulation that doctors are also getting vaccinated and general practitioners who
yes.
are not helping it in this care.
Yes, I think from a health point of view, you could say, well, all the balls to the elder people saves the most lives. But I also see that all these doctors who are in on the TV every evening, they used their TV power to force the minister to also give some vaccinations to people who work there. I can see the point. They have to do the work. They want to be protected. So I from their point of view, I see their plea, and I also see that the minister can't ignore them, because they are so powerful in the media. But the health council said, well, let's just focus on. So now we have the health council says 90% of the vaccines to all the people, and 10% you can use for any other group. And that is kind of endorsed by the minister right now.
Okay, well, that's interesting. I certainly like that conversation. If you look at another order of people who yes. go to somewhere, we can look at what happens in the case of code black on intensive care.
Yes.
We saw this in Italy where yes. the intensive care, there was weren't enough spots for yes. people to get all on intensive care. And yes. what basically happened is that there were doctors had to make a decision.
Yes.
You can stay in the bed and you have to get off. Is there any regulation on this? Because in my opinion, as I heard on television, case of code black, doctors decide what's going to happen.
Yes. There is regulation which is indirectly accepted by government, by parliament and by minister, and that is set up by doctors and medical ethicists, and they say, of course, the medical condition of the individual person, in normal cases, the medical condition of the individual person should determine whether you go to the IC or not, intensive care units. But in this situation of code black, there are more people who need the beds than there are beds. So it's not the individual assessment of the individual medical assessment of the patients, but some other measurement. And the decision there by this group of medical doctors and ethicists is that they say, whether you are a parent of young children or whether you are free-floating, non-parent, that doesn't matter. Your personal situation in the outside world doesn't matter. Whether you are unemployed or whether you run a big company, that shouldn't influence the decision. The only thing that should influence is the age cohort in which you live. So it's not this decision between someone of 81 and 79, but for example, if you have to choose between someone of 80 years old and 20 years old, you have to choose for the 20 years old person. And the argument is the fair ending argument. Someone who's 80 years old had a chance to live a fulfilling life. Someone of 20 years old just at the start of it all. And they said, well, there's a reason to treat them equally, saying, well, you had your chance to live a fulfilling life. You're just starting, so we should give the bed to the 20-year-old person. And I agree with that proposal.
And so if I'm a doctor on intensive care and I see my brother laying there,
yes.
who is 40 years old,
yes.
and it's someone who is 25 years old, do I have the choice as a doctor to have my brother there and leave someone off? Because I feel like, yes, there are regulations, but how is that enforced? Is that automatically you're just going to get kicked off based by age?
No. So the idea was these doctors have to make these decisions. The moment that these decisions arrive, we are in a IC that is overfilled with persons. We are in a situation where people fall ill, where these doctors are completely overwhelmed, overtired. They can't make very deep decisions at that moment. This is not a regulation, but this set of rules is a guide to doctors to make the decision. But if you as a doctor would prefer let's make it a bit harsher, your 65-year-old father over an 18-year-old student, and it would turn out that you choose your own father over someone who should be earlier, I think even without this regulation, you would be in trouble because you can't, this is kind of a basic medical ethic, well, basic ethical conviction.
Yeah.
You shouldn't take your family, you shouldn't give your family a special privilege.
David, and another thing we could definitely talk about, and I think a lot of people would agree with this statement, is that people who decide not to get vaccinated, for example, because of religious reasons,
yes.
because God, you shouldn't interfere with God's
yes,
way,
yes, yes.
They then don't get a spot on intensive care as well.
Yes.
I think perhaps more than half of the country would agree with this statement.
Yes.
Would you?
Well, I wrote about this in the Gelderlander, a local newspaper. My argument is that I wouldn't, even though here I would say again, this is gritting teeth tolerance. I mean, the choices you make before you arrive at the IC unit should not involve the choices whether you are accepted or not. Because if you have a driver's license, you drink too much beer tonight, and then you drive home to your parents, you make an accident. Should these people also say, well, he drunk and drive, so he shouldn't be assessed, he shouldn't be allowed in the IC? No, we say, well, it's very stupid what you did there, but the moment you arrive at the IC, we help you. And it's not it's not that we say, well, one person was drunk and the other wasn't. That's not a reason why we don't accept you in the IC. So here also, if you don't take the vaccination, it's stupid. But I think in the end of the day, that should not determine your chance of access to the IC. But I know this is quite contested.
Yeah, because I can imagine that there's a difference with you drinking, not really knowing the risk, getting in a car, getting in an accident, versus saying beforehand, if you do not want to take the vaccine, then you don't get a spot in the intensive care.
Yeah.
People have knowledge beforehand. They have days to make their decision. They have a valid consent form. In that case, would it still be unjustifiable?
Well, I wouldn't agree with it. But I know that this is, I mean, here the liberalism or the focus on tolerance towards different ideas of the good life wins for me. In that sense, I think, I come from the Bible. I'm born and raised in the Bible Belt, not as a Christian, but I know what's going on there. I think it's unjustifiable. It's also unjustifiable what happened in the churches in Urk and in Rotterdam, where these journalists were kicked out and nearly. I think it's outrageous. At the same time, a liberal democracy should have some tolerance towards those who make decisions that we think are completely irresponsible.
Okay, well. I think a lot of people disagree, but
yeah, that's
we're not letting democracy decide on these ethical topics.
No. In the end, democracy will decide, because it could be that the parliament makes decisions.
True.
And it could be that, and I think that there might be a majority in parliament who is in favor of decisions like you propose. Still, I disagree with them, but that's the fun thing of being an ethicist. You can still disagree, even if it's made law.
We already hit a bit upon the distribution of vaccinations,
yes.
So I want to come back to there, because we've now, the world has purchased enough vaccines to vaccinate 80% of the population.
Yes.
However, if you look at the distribution, Western countries, for example, the United Kingdom has 2.5 times, bought 2.5 times as much,
yes,
vaccines as they need,
yes,
while poor countries only bought 30 or even less.
Yeah.
To what extent are government behaving in an unethical manner, the rich governments behaving in an unethical manner?
Well, I think, and I can understand that these governments in such a pandemic really want to make sure that their own citizens are protected. And when these decisions to choose for a vaccine were made, it was not clear which of the vaccines would work and which wouldn't. So they basically bought everything, and they said, well, if any of them work, we'll have them. It also the case that they also spent quite some money for these vaccines to be already to be produced, even though they didn't know whether they would work. So these countries also took a bet. It could they have spent millions and millions of euros for the production of vaccines that weren't tested already. So it could very well be that they've spent all that money for a vaccine that wasn't helpful. So they made those choices. Now we have arrived in a situation where many of these vaccines that they bought already, they all work. Some better, some less good, but they all are way above the threshold of being effective and safe. Also AstraZeneca. We have some discussion about it, but if we had AstraZeneca a year ago, people say, oh, that's great. And now we have the better ones. We kind of, okay. These countries bought all these vaccines. And I think it would be too naive to assume that they would ship those vaccines to third world countries before their own population are vaccinated. I mean, it might be better in the long run, also for the countries themselves, but they can't sell it to their own population. We don't vaccinate you. We send the vaccines to other countries.
Yes, because there are medical experts, or in the United Kingdom now wants to perhaps even vaccinate people 3 times.
Yes.
Well, medical experts disagree with them and say no. Yes. This way first. So that's so weird to me. How can they do this?
Well, there could come up new strands of COVID where we do need a third vaccination. But I think we should be realistic and say, well, these Western countries should be allowed to vaccinate their own population, because you could disagree with that, but that won't fly. But I do think that these extra vaccines that are bought in, they should go right to developing countries the moment that their own population is vaccinated. Even more, I think also for the self-interest, they should really invest a lot of money now to vaccinate people in poor countries. Because as we discussed earlier, in those areas where there are not enough vaccination, new strands can develop and they can also come back to us again. So it's not only an issue of global justice that the more rich countries in the world spend a lot of money to also protect persons in the developing countries, but it's also a self-interest, because you can be vaccinated here in the Netherlands, but there's a new strand developing in somewhere in Africa that isn't caught by our vaccination, then we are at square one again. So it's really important to vaccinate the world as a whole.
Yeah, so shifting from government responsibility to corporate responsibility,
yes.
We've seen that AstraZeneca charges double the price in South Africa than in the United Kingdom.
Yes.
Shouldn't governments put a limit to this corporate greed? And to what extent, how does that work? How can companies do this ethically, and why do governments allow it?
Well, it's the market, and the market is not necessarily ethical. The market in itself is not ethical restraint, because whatever you want to pay, I don't have to explain the market. But the question is, which government should do that? For example, England itself played the card of vaccine nationalism, where they bought every vaccine that was available. So England itself, as a country, also didn't act very ethically. So the question is whether it should be the United Nations. Well, that's not the strongest power player in the world. Coming up with an ethical perspective that's very widely shared is one thing, but finding a potent actor to enforce the policy on the global scale, well, that's the whole problem of globalization. That's very difficult.
So you do think that this profit motive should be changed, but it's just very hard to achieve?
I don't see how states will give up their sovereign power for a more globalized alternative. So I think it's something that we have to accept, because we can't change it. Not because it's good, but simply because these states will not accept any limitation of their sovereign power. We should try within that system to make the system as ethical as possible. But that's a very limited, you're very limited if you want to do that.
Yeah, because for example, we can look at the break-even point where pharmaceutical companies get all their costs out.
Yes.
That seems also ethical. Companies shouldn't take a loss because, well, that's an argument there. But the World Trade Organization does have the power to limit competition and say it like that.
Or for example, they should take away the patents for these vaccines, so they can be developed in India. They have all these companies where they can make these vaccines quite cheaply. I think that's a very important question, but I haven't thought about that much to come up with a very supported answer to it. I don't know.
Do you think it should be thought out more by government, by the World Trade Organization, by these companies even themselves? Because indeed, perhaps we don't think about it enough, but it is such an important ethical topic, and it can help the world improve way better if these patents are reduced.
I think, I mean, this is, I mean, what I said up to now is supported by a lot of thinking. It might, you might still disagree, but that's supported by a lot of thinking. This is kind of off the cuff, and I say, given the fact that, I mean, if the bottleneck is in the production of vaccines, if that's the problem, and if we know that if we don't vaccinate fast enough worldwide, they might develop new strains that could completely destroy everything that we have achieved right now, there could be an argument to at least for 2 years limit the rights of patents and say, well, as long as this pandemic rages, the patents should be taken, they should be compensated well, these companies, but we should really take away all the bottlenecks to ensure that the world popularity, the people of the world, are all vaccinated as fast as possible.
Okay, well, we've come to our final question already.
Good.
The final question is a bit more personal one.
Yes.
Because if you personally could implement one law or regulation in the Netherlands related to the current pandemic, what would it be?
I think I would take away the decision power on these vaccination policies away from the ministry for 6 months and put it in the hand of the RIVM. The RIVM is the organization that does the practical work in this in distributing the vaccination. I think at the moment one of the problems is that politicians, many people try to influence politicians. The politicians try to serve every group, and that doesn't make the best straightforward policy. I think the RIVM should be free for the next 6 months, free from governmental interference, to make the decision on the distribution of vaccinations. I think that would really help.
Put Jaap van Dissel in charge.
Put
all the vaccination.
Put Hans van Vliet in charge. Hans van Vliet is in the end the practical person who does all the practical stuff. Let him decide in with Jaap van Vliet and all the others about the distribution of the vaccination. The politicians should do all the other things, but those vaccines who arrive here in the Netherlands, let the RIVM, in discussion with the Gezondheidsraad on the more distributed questions, let them do the work for 6 months. I think that would do the trick for the Netherlands.
Perhaps they're listening. We'll see if that regulation will be implemented. I'm not sure about it.
I'll forward this to Hans van Vliet. He would love this answer, I'm quite sure.
Well, thanks a lot for this interview.
I really enjoyed it.
Me too. I hope the audience really enjoyed it. And thank you again.
Thank you very much.